سلام به شما دوستان عزیز، همراهان، همزبانان و هموطنانی که بیننده این برنامه هستید. من فریدا صبا هستم و برنامه دهکده جهانی رو به شما تقدیم میکنم.
Nasrin Sotoudeh is a prominent lawyer in Iran who's been fighting for children's rights, women's rights, and human rights.
She is one of the bravest voices in Iran.
She took on cases that other lawyers were too afraid to take on.
We've seen Nasrin Sotoudeh jailed for defending human rights.
And it has cost her and her young family a lot.
Protesting against the law which forces Iranian women to wear the hijab.
The country's most prominent human rights activist and a voice for the voiceless.
I had been in Iran maybe a week, and I knew how to toe the line as a woman. And then I meet Nasrin Sotoudeh, who doesn't toe the line at all.
بله، در مورد نسرین ستوده، وکیل مدافع سرشناس ایرانی که به خاطر دفاع از حقوق زنان، کودکان، اقلیت‌ها و زندانیان سیاسی سالیان سال است که در زندان جمهوری اسلامی به سر می‌برد، فیلم‌های متعددی در مورد زندگی و فعالیت‌های او ساخته شده. او هم اکنون به عنوان یکی از سرشناس‌ترین چهره‌های بین‌المللی در زمینه حقوق بشر به شمار می‌رود. در برنامه امروز به این موضوع می‌پردازیم. توجه کنید.
از بسیاری از افرادی که به خاطر بیان عقایدش خودشون به زندان رفتند، مجانی دفاع کرد.
I was looking for a lawyer that could be that strong, that could stand up to the judicial and intelligence officers and authorities. And Nasrin Sotoudeh was the person.
Her peaceful activism and insisting that the judges and the entire system should follow their own procedures is a thorn in the side of Iranian authorities. Nasrin Sotoudeh emerged as the most outspoken, brave, and fearless advocate of these detainees and started following up many of these cases, defending them.
سعی میکرد اطلاع رسانی بکنه، افکار عمومی رو به کمک میطلبید. مجموع اینها باعث شد که او رو دستگیر کنند.
What is Sotoudeh is in jail for today is simply for doing her job. We have not faced such a crisis in Iran with regard to the human rights situation. It is the worst that it has been in the last 20 years.
قوه قضاییه استقلال خودش رو از دست داده و روز به روزم بدتر میشه.
Journalists, student leaders, women's rights advocates, lawyers, and regular citizens who have dared to question authority are thrown behind jails and are held in terrible conditions. So today is an award that is controlled by the intelligence ministry. People are locked up in solitary confinement for month after month after month.
Every single moment takes like hours and days and months. And it's a horrifying situation. The authorities want to break her. They want to put her on her knees. The more we talk about Nasrin Sotoudeh and the others who are in a similar situation, the more we put pressure on the Iranian government to release them.
وقتی که قاضی حاضر نیست قانون رو اجرا بکنه و حاضر نیست به اعتراضات وکیل گوش کنه، چاره ای نیست جز اینکه از وجدان عمومی جامعه کمک بگیریم.
There are many people today in Iran who are looking for her to lead them in gaining civil and equal rights. If Sotoudeh is released, she herself can become the agent of that change, and she will not be alone.
Nasreen Sotoudeh is a prominent lawyer in Iran who's been fighting for children's rights, women's rights, and human rights.
She is one of the bravest voices in Iran.
She took on cases that other lawyers were too afraid to take on.
We've seen Nasreen Sotoudeh jailed for defending human rights.
And it has cost her and her young family a lot.
Protesting against the law which forces Iranian women to wear the hijab.
The country's most prominent human rights activist and a voice for the voiceless.
I had been in Iran maybe a week, and I knew how to toe the line as a woman. And then I meet Nasreen Sotoudeh, who doesn't toe the line at all.
On Wednesday, Nasreen Sotoudeh was again arrested. She had been tried and convicted in absentia. According to her husband, she intends to continue her activism from prison.
بله، فیلمی که مشاهده کردید مربوط است به فیلم نسرین که توسط یکی از کارگردانان سرشناس آمریکا آقای جف کافمن تهیه و تولید شده. مهمان امروز برنامه من جف کافمن هستند و اجازه بدید به ایشون خوش آمد بگیم. Welcome to the program, Jeff.
Thank you, Frida. It's really a pleasure to be here.
Well, Jeff, congratulations on the success of your film. Tell us a little bit about your acquaintance with Nasreen Sotoudeh. How did you learn about Nasreen?
I've done a number of documentaries about Iran over the years, and each film I've done has given me a deeper appreciation of the Iranian people and Iranian culture. I think one of the lessons we learn in both countries is that you can't judge the people of a country by their leadership. There's often a big gulf. I'd done a film maybe 10 years ago about the persecution of the Baha'i faith in Iran. And if you know about that concern, Baha'is are not allowed to go to college. They're often prohibited from having certain jobs. There's horrible discrimination, harassment, and often violence against Baha'is in Iran. Heard many stories about how Muslim neighbors, Muslim friends would put themselves at risk to help Baha'i friends and neighbors move forward in life. And there's no greater champion of religious tolerance, religious diversity, and so many other human rights concerns than Nasreen Sotoudeh. Nasreen, you know, is one of the great advocates of children's rights and women's rights. Journalists and artists, and a campaigner against the death penalty. So my admiration for her from far away was enormous. And in the middle of 2016, our producer Marsha Ross and I reached out to Nasreen through mutual friends to see if we could do a documentary about her life and work. When we started to talk about it, we had shared concerns and interests right at the beginning, and that's really what prompted this, you know, now 4-year plus journey that has, among other things, given us a chance to become long-distance friends with Nazreen and her remarkable husband, Reza. I just want to say that you know her, many people know her as this global icon for human rights. Sometimes people who do great things are not necessarily great people personally, and I can attest that Nazreen and Reza are just such remarkable human beings, you know, warm and funny and determined and supportive and truly, truly great. So it's been one of the honors of our lives.
It's extraordinary film. I saw it. And Iran and its culture on media here is known only, it's only associated with terrorism and all the bad news you hear from Iran. And it's between US and Iran, but it's not between Iranian people and Americans.
I'm so glad you said that. It was always one of our goals to, through Nazreen's life, connect to a community of activists who are fighting for women's rights and a better Iran. She always wants now to use her work to advocate for others. But we also shared, like I said before, a similar interest in portraying Iranian culture in a new and vibrant way. I'm very distressed the way this country so often demonizes Iran. First of all, as one solid chunk, as if it's not really people at all, and also only seeing the country by its leaders. Really, there's such diversity and vibrancy and history in Iran, it's endlessly worth getting to know. And because Nazreen really strongly believes that that culture is a powerful way to push society forward, and she just loves every aspect of it. Following her, we got to, you know, connect to art galleries and a theater in Tehran that would look just like a theater in Greenwich Village. Poetry reading, even women sitting around a yarn circle making puppets. It was such a pleasure to follow Nazreen in all those aspects of life. And I hope for people in America and around the world, they'll realize, oh my goodness, this is a country that I can connect to and respect and relate to, and that I want to get to know better.
You have shed really light on the movements of Iranian women. It's a very strong movement.
It's truly remarkable. The women's rights movement in many ways parallels what's happened in this country. Sharon Abadi, the Nobel Peace Prize laureate, points out that women in Iran got the right to vote before women in Switzerland did.
Exactly.
And, it's been a 100-year plus struggle for women's rights in Iran and longer. Actually, we point out at the beginning of the film that there's been pushed forward and pushed backwards for women's rights dating back over a millennia. But one of the things that's also really touching is when you get to see the faces and get to know the stories of these women. If you go back just to the time of the revolution and forward, you have women putting themselves at risk and really putting themselves at the forefront of Iran to call for basic human rights and basic equality. And oftentimes putting themselves at great risk to do so, being arrested, being beaten, being separated from their families, being put into exile. And yet this women's rights movement in Iran doesn't stop. And the courage of these women and the vision of these women is inspiring, I think, for anybody. But here in this country, in America, where we see some of our rights being pushed backwards, I think these women are role models for how we should get involved and what we should do.
And they're ready to pay the price. As you said, they're paying the price with their lives and freedom and everything they have for the goals they are following. There are so many other Iranian women that they are fighting for freedom of women.
Last March, it seems 100 years ago because it was at the beginning of COVID, we did a documentary for Time magazine called 40 Million. The struggle for women's rights in Iran. And we used some of the elements that we weren't able to use in the Nazreen film to tell that story. And one of the significant individuals in that film as well was Narges Mahmoud, a very brave woman, and her husband has paid a high sacrifice for human rights as well, as have their children.
It must be very difficult for you to get footages from within Iran. Walk us through the production of film, your documentary film, Nazreen.
Sure. I mean, normally when you film a documentary, you line up next to the person that you're focusing on or the group of people, and you spend as much time as you can, and you have, you know, a large crew, a sound person, a camera person, and others. That wouldn't have worked for going to Iran. First of all, I've done 4 or 5 other films about Iran, so I could not have gone if I had wanted to. And second of all, if an American crew had shown up to follow Nasrin Sotoudeh around, we would have got about 2 seconds of footage before being sent away. So instead, we worked with some really talented and, again, courageous filmmakers who stayed close to Nasrin and didn't just shoot her in the confines of her office or her home, but walking down the street and driving and, like I said before, going to a bookstore and an art gallery and protests. The access was really remarkable. They were all putting themselves at risk to do this, so were everybody in the film. Everyone knew what the risks were and signed a release, you know, granting us permission. You know, I can't express the gratitude that Marcia and I and everyone else have for these remarkable people. They're colleagues, but thousands of miles away.
Yes, I wish your wife, Marcia Ross, who is also the producer of this great documentary you guys made, and I wish she could be present during our conversation. We can do it some other time. Have her.
She has an obligation at the moment, but I encourage you to talk to her because she has her own really deep well of experience to share with you.
I don't want to get into politics, but you cannot avoid politics. These days, yeah. Everything is politics. Well, there is an animosity between United States and Iran, the country that you kindly have interest in their people, in the culture, and you have worked a lot on Iran. Don't you think Iran and United States, who have been friends for 100 plus years and had friendly ties, don't you think they should be friends again? And if you believe so, how could it be started?
Well, you know, it's an interesting question because is politics and history the same thing? I think it's really important for Americans who so often don't have a good sense of history to understand really what the roots of the conflict are with Iran and just actually have an honest assessment of our own country. You know, if you ask for human rights, if you demand human rights in another country, you darn well better ask for human rights in your own country as well. If you don't have the same standard for yourself, you have no moral high ground in any other country. And it's got to apply, by the way, to friends and so-called enemies. Otherwise, you're just trying to score political points. So, I would call on all Americans to better understand America's complicated relationship with Iran. And yes, we had a long-time relationship with Iran that would sometimes seem positive, but, you know, oftentimes it wasn't an equal relationship. The West was often sucking out resources from Iran, not benefiting the people of Iran. And that's a long and unpleasant history. Iran has also done some had behaviors that are detestable, and those should be called out as well, especially their human rights record. So how do we go forward now? Well, there was obviously in place a nuclear accord that didn't really address human rights at all. It didn't address other aspects of foreign policy, but it was a start for communication and building credibility and some trust. I hope that the Biden administration and the next administration in Iran, because there's an election coming up, will find a way to move forward on that, and that can give a foundation for further connection. There are forces in both countries that really don't want to know each other, that really don't want to communicate and don't want to have mutual respect. There are forces in both countries that want to have disagreement and conflict. I hope that we can empower the sides in both that are realistic and smart, but also realize that the best way to move forward is with communication and respect.
My other question was that during the making your film, your documentary on Nasrin, did the people in Iran who helped you, did they get into trouble or they're all safe and sound now?
Well, no one got into trouble for helping us make the film itself, thank goodness. And I have to say that my producing partner, Marcia Ross, and I, and we're also married, so we work together on several levels. But many, many times, Marcia and I would say to Nazreen and to her husband, Reza, we, as much as we want to do this film, we do not want to move forward if it puts you or anyone else at risk. That's not worth it. We don't want anyone to get hurt because of the making of this film, and no one has been. But I'm sorry to say that a number of people that we got to know through the film have had issues since. Obviously, Nazreen, for her work as a human rights activist and a women's rights activist, was arrested in June 2018. Most recently, she was released on medical leave November 7th of this year. She has COVID and a heart condition. She had been told just last week that medical leave would be extended by a couple of weeks because she still has a lot of treatment and recovery to come. And then the very next day, she was told, nope, you're going back to prison. So she's now back in Garchak prison, a terribly unsanitary and an unfit place with virtually no medical support. And it's a true crime against humanity.
Well, I'm sure people are interested to watch your documentary, Nazreen. Could you tell us how people can watch it, online or otherwise?
Sure. You know, this is a strange time with COVID and people having to stay at home, but we're having what's called a virtual theatrical premiere all around the country and actually all around North America, so in Canada as well. If you go to our website, which is www.nazreenfilm.com, that's going to start on December 18th. So on December 18th, just go to www.nazreenfilm.com and you'll find a very easy way to see the film. You can also go to the website to keep finding out more information about Nazreen and also to sign a petition to call for her release.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for your time. Wish you ever more success for you and for your dear wife, Marcia.
Thanks so much, Frida. I appreciate it.
دخترم از شوهرم خواستم الان آوردن وسط مصاحبه ما دخترم هم اومد اگه اشکال نداره میتونم بگم بیاد چون این همش سختی های کار منو میبینه به من میگه از وکالت متنفرم بیاد مثلا این چیزا رو ببینه که دختران از آغاز 10 سالگی و پسران از آغاز 16 سالگی به عنوان یک فرد بالغ مورد سوال در جامعه قرار می گیرن و مسئولیت کیفری به اونها تحمیل میشه. ما در اینجا می بینیم که قوانین داخلی ایران چقدر با تعهدات بین المللیش در تعارض قرار می گیره. دولت ایران طبق ماده 37 کنوانسیون حقوق کودک که به اون پیوسته در سال 82 در سال 71 موظف هست از اعدام افراد زیر 18 سال خودداری کنه به موجب بند 5 از ماده 6 میثاق حقوق مدنی سیاسی هم اعدام افرادی که در زمان ارتکاب جرم زیر 18 سال دارن ممنوعه به موجب ماده 49 قانون مجازات اسلامی فقط اطفال از مسئولیت کیفری ما بر راه هستند. طبق صراحت کنوانسیون حقوق کودک هم دولت مسئول اجرای مفاد تعهدات بین المللی از جمله این کنوانسیون هست.
خب متاسفانه به پایان وقت برنامه امروز رسیدیم. امیدوارم که از گفتگوی این هفته استفاده کرده باشید. با سپاس از شما که بیننده این برنامه بودید و همچنین کلیه همکارانم در این سو و آن سو تا وقتی دیگر و دیداری دوباره بدرود و باد.